Ladies and gentlemen, once again, your WREP players. All over the world, electric power has been neutralized on the stroke of noon. As a token of the spaceman's power, and as a way of warning the Earth. While they've been trapped between floors in an elevator, the spaceman has told Kelly his identity and purpose here.
I've already told you more than I told Professor Barnhart, because my life, in a sense, is in your hand. But if I die, the world, your world, may die too.
Yes, I understand.
I thought if you knew the facts, you'd appreciate the importance of my not being caught before the meeting tonight with the world's scientists.
Yes, of course. Of course I do. You hold great hope for this meeting, don't you?
I can see no other hope for your planet. If the meeting should fail, I'm afraid there is no hope.
Oh, the lights. And we've started again.
Well, it must be 12:30.
Yes, exactly. Where are you going now?
Back to the boarding house. I'll be safe there for the afternoon. I'll be able to keep an eye on Bobby. He's the only other person who knows about me.
No. Wait a minute. There is someone else.
How? There can't be.
Tom. He was with me last night when Bobby told me what he saw.
Oh.
Well, of course, he doesn't know anything definite and, well... He talked to me first before, but then we can't take a chance, can we?
Can you get in touch with him?
I think so.
I mean at once, now.
I'll try.
You will. You must.
Morgan, this is Mr. Stevens. I just got in. Now listen, call the Pentagon. Who? Mrs. Benson? When? Yeah, okay, well, never mind. This is more important. Listen, now call the Pentagon and find out who's in charge of the space business. Whoever it is, I want to talk to him.
Tom!
Call back right away and don't make any other calls. Brush them off fast.
Tom, I've been trying to get to you all afternoon.
Got some pretty terrific news about your good friend, Mr. Carpenter.
Oh, what about him?
He's the man from the spaceship. I had that diamond, or whatever it is, checked in 3 different places. Nobody on Earth sees a stone like that. And after what Bobby told us, that's good enough for me. Why is it nobody even knows about this Mr. Carpenter? How come he doesn't have any money?
All right, Tom, it's true.
Yeah, how do you know?
You've just got to promise me you won't say a word to anybody.
Oh, nobody but the Pentagon.
Please, Tom.
Are you crazy? After what happened today, he's a menace.
You don't understand. You don't realize how important this is.
Important? Of course it's important, and we can do something about it.
We mustn't do anything about it. Tom, believe me, I know what I'm talking about.
I say he's dangerous. It's our duty to turn him in.
He isn't dangerous. He isn't a menace. He told me what he came here for.
Oh, honey, don't be silly. Because you happen to like the guy. Do you realize what this will mean for us? I'll be the biggest fan in the country. I'll write my own ticket.
Is that what you're thinking about?
Listen, somebody's got to get rid of him.
Tom, I'm not going to let you do it. Tom, don't do it.
Hello, Margaret? Yeah. General Cutler? Good. I'll hold on.
You don't know what you're doing. It isn't just you and Mr. Carpenter.
Mr.
carpenter.
It's everybody. The rest of the world is involved.
I'm gonna hang about the rest of the world. I'm in this for me.
Tom!
Now, you'll feel different when you see my picture in the papers.
I feel different right now.
Well, you'll see. You're gonna marry a hero.
I'm not going to marry anybody. Not even a hero.
Hey, hey, Helen! Oh, hello? General Cutler? General, my name is Tom Stevens, with a V. I have some positive information about the spaceman and where he's staying. Right. Yep. Yep. Of course I'm sure. He's living in a boarding house at 1615 M Street, Northwest. That is correct, General.
Yeah, I have it all now, Mr. Stevens. Thank you very much, indeed. I want to talk to you more further, but I haven't time now. We have to act on this.
Yes, sir.
Have Colonel Reiner deploy all Zone 5 units according to Plan B immediately. Investigate 1615 M Street Northwest for presence of the spaceman. I repeat, 1565.
Mr. Carpenter!
Right here. Did you see Tom? What does he say?
It's no good. It's too late. I've got the taxi outside. Hurry!
Attention, Zone 5. Attention, Zone 5. Man and woman observed entering taxi at 1615 M Street, Northwest. Man is probably platoon, alias Carpenter. Establish roadblocks according to Plan Baker. And maintain station. Remain on radio alert until further orders.
Joe Barnhart can arrange to hide me until the meeting tonight.
Where is he going to be?
At the ship. Now look there. Army car.
Full troops in full gear.
The alarm is out, all right.
It's only a few more blocks from Professor Barnhart's.
I'm worried about Gort. I'm afraid of what he might do if anything should happen to me.
Gort? But he's a robot.
He's a product of centuries of refinement.
But what could he do without you?
There's no limit to what he could do. He could destroy the Earth.
And the city is swarming with patrol cars, hunting you. How can we tell them?
They won't listen. You must listen. If anything happens to me, you must go to Gort. You must give him this message. Klaatu Barada Niktov. Gort. Klaatu Barada Niktov. Say it.
Gort. Klaatu Barada
Nikto.
Gort. Klaatu Barada Nikto. Klaatu Barada Nikto.
Remember those words.
Klaatu Barada Nikto. Klaatu Barada Nikto.
Attention, Zone 5. Taxi cab moving north on 14th Street from Harvard Street. Man and woman in backseat. License number H0012. H-O-O-1-2, Section 2, close in, this is your target vehicle.
We're hemmed in. Driver, we'll get out here. I'm gonna try to run for it. If they get me, you go to Gort. Now!
Gort somehow knew that Klaatu was dead. Gort was already on the move. He was on the move toward Helen.
No. No, Gort, no!
visor of his helmet was opening on the cosmic incandescence within, seething with whirlpool, aiming impassively at Helen.
Gort! Gort! Klaatu! Klaatu! Barada! Barada! And Nikto!
Helen Benson fainted. When she returned to consciousness, she was lying on a dais bathed in soft, shadowy light. In a chamber vaguely circular, a completely unfamiliar building. She was in the space machine. Across the room stood Gort with his back to her, and lying in front of him on a platform was Klaatu.
Mr. Carpenter.
Gort, the machine, the automat, was applying electrodes to his master, and a piercing, whining, maddened sound filled the ship. Sat up, stood up.
Mr. Carpenter.
Hello.
I thought you were.
I was. They took me to an emergency hospital at the city jail. Gort broke in and took me back here. This technique can restore life in some cases, only for a limited time.
How long?
No one can tell. Time enough and more for me to go outside and speak to Professor Barnhart's scientists. I must speak to them. It's what I came for. Gort will put out the WREP.
Oh my, what's your hand? What's going on? Something.
You, people of Earth. You, men of science, you are here from all over your world. Europe, Asia, representing many nations, many ideas. I am leaving soon. You will forgive me if I speak bluntly. The universe grows smaller every day. Where I come from, we believe there must be security for all, or no one. Is secure. This does not mean giving up any freedom except the freedom to act irresponsibly. This is the message that I ask you to take back when you return to your native lands. Tell your people and your governments that we have created a race of robots whose function it is to patrol the planets in spaceships and preserve the peace. At the first sign of treachery, they will act automatically. Nothing you have here on Earth can stop them. The penalty for provoking their action is too terrible to risk.
Oh my. What are we gonna do?
Your choice is simple. Live in peace or perish in violence. We shall be waiting your answer. The decision rests with you. Gort, Berengo. Remember.
I'll remember, Mr. Carpenter.
Spaceship, it's taken off.
As they had seen him come, so they seen him depart. People of the Earth pondered upon the war.
Nooks and Daddy.
supposed to come over, so I sent Snooks out for a deck of cards. I gave her another dollar, and she disappeared for over 2 hours. I got worried and called the drugstore. And, hello, Mr. Lynn? This is Mr. Higgins. Has Snooks been in your store? Oh, I see. $2. Mm-hmm. Didn't even ask for cards, eh? Well, thank you, Mr. Lynn. Goodbye. Snooks, is that you? Snooks, is that you, Snooks?
It's only the cat, Daddy. Meow.
Cat, ma'am. Come into this room at once.
Hello, Daddy.
Where were you tiptoeing so stealthily, my child?
Huh?
Why did you try to sneak upstairs?
Mummy told me to clean Robespierre's room. He's gonna help me.
How nice.
Yeah, yesterday I made the bed with him, and today I'm gonna mop up the floor with him.
What a helpful little girl you've turned out to be.
Yeah, I think I'll...
Now look, just a minute. Before you engage in your domestic duties, I think you should come into this room and close the door behind you.
Why?
Because we're going to have a little powwow.
Huh?
I said we're going to have a little powwow.
Did the dog have pups?
The dog did not have pups.
Why?
Look, in the first place, our dog is a male, and then secondly, it's entirely irrelevant.
I thought it was an Airedale.
It is an Airedale.
Well, can't Airedales have...
Airedales can't have anything any other dog can have.
Can they have Scotch?
No, I didn't call you to discuss Gordon dog breeding, and I don't want to talk about the dogs at all.
You want to talk about cats?
No!
Why?
Because I don't. I called you into this room because I have a boat to pick with you.
We're back to the dogs again, Daddy.
Don't be facetious. Now sit down.
Yes, Daddy.
Now look at that clock.
I'm looking, Daddy.
What time is it?
It's Maxwell House.
No, we've done that.
I want to do it again.
Snooks!
I want to do it again!
Now, you can't stop it right now. You should have been here 2 hours ago.
Why? What happened?
Nothing happened. Snooks, didn't I send you on an errand earlier this evening? Or could it be that my imagination is playing tricks on me? Could that be?
Could be.
Very careful, Snooks. I'm in no mood to tolerate any nonsense tonight. 2 hours ago, I gave you $2. Is that right?
Uh-huh.
And I told you you might keep one of those dollars for yourself. Is that right?
Uh-huh.
With the other dollar, I asked you to purchase a packet of playing cards so I could play poker. Is that right?
Mommy says it ain't, but you keep on playing just...
Never mind what Mommy says. I'll live my life without being regimented by Mommy.
Ooh, Daddy.
Like that smirk off your face. Now, what happened after you left the house?
I lost one of the dollars.
Well, where are my cards?
I didn't get no cards.
Why not?
Because it was your dollar I lost.
I see, it was my dollar. Then you still have $1 left, I take it.
You can't take it because I ain't got it.
Where is it?
Where's what?
The second dollar.
You didn't ask me how I lost the first dollar yet.
All right, how did you lose the first dollar?
I don't know.
Well, that's one. I try to be a good father to you, give everything you want, and you consistently take advantage of it. And to think, you pull such a trick on this of all days.
It's the only day you gave me a dollar.
I'm not talking about that. Do you know what day this is?
Dollar Day?
No, it's Father's Day. Why do you think I gave you that extra dollar?
Because you didn't want me to tell Mommy you were going to play poker with...
Nothing of the kind. I thought you might be decent enough to buy your poor old daddy a little present. Instead of that, you squander the money and come back with a flock of untruths.
No, Daddy.
Well, tell me the truth. What did you do with the $2?
I bought you a present.
Oh? What kind of present?
A bicycle.
You brought me a bicycle for $2.
It didn't have no wheels.
I see, but where is it?
I was riding home.
Now, wait a minute. How could you ride a bicycle if it had no wheels?
It had pedals.
So what good are pedals without wheels?
That's what I said. So I threw the whole thing away.
All right, Snooks, I'm not bandying words with you any longer. I want the truth right now. Now, what did you do with the money?
I lost it in a poker game.
I told you I want the truth. Tell me everything that happened from the moment you left the house. You had $2, didn't you?
Uh-huh.
Well?
Well, I started to go to the drugstore, and they grabbed the money.
Who grabbed the money?
The four burglars.
What four burglars?
What did you say, Daddy?
You said four burglars grabbed the money. Well, I'm waiting.
I'm thinking, Daddy.
Are these the same four burglars that made you play hooky from school, that made you break the window, and made you tear up my stamp collection?
Yeah! What do they want from me, Daddy?
I know what I want from you. I want the truth. Now, this is a very serious matter. Switzerland, I won't accept any cock and bull story.
Why?
Because that burglar stuff is one thing. You don't think I'm going to fall for that yarn about four burglars anymore, do you?
How about five burglars?
Come on, Snoop. Now, you can do better than that.
I know I can, but you're rushing me.
Listen, Snopes, it'd be much easier for you if you just tell the truth. Then you won't have to bother making up these fantastic stories.
It ain't no bother, Daddy.
This is the last time I listened to you and Frank Morgan. Now, come on, tell me what happened to the money. The truth this time.
All right, Daddy. I'll tell you the truth.
That's better. The absolute truth.
Yes, Dad.
Go. What happened to the money?
I was holding it in my hand like this.
Yes.
And when I pushed out my hand, it got stuck on his horn.
Whose horn?
The tiger's horn. He started...
Now stop that, Snow. Are you telling me you saw a tiger?
Uh-huh.
With a horn? Lions and tigers. I'm going to see this thing through to the bitter end.
That's what the lion did to the tiger, Daddy.
What?
He bit her
again. Oh, so I've had enough of this.
Me too. Good night, Daddy.
Now, listen, you stay right here. I just called Mr. Lim at the drugstore, and he told me you spent $2 on candy and ice cream.
Did he?
He did. Now, I suppose you're ready to drop this hocus pocus?
I'll take him off if you want me to, Daddy.
I mean, are you ready to confess? But I can't see for the life of me how you managed to do away with $2 worth of candy and ice cream all by yourself.
I didn't need it, Daddy.
Well, then who did?
Nobody. I hid it in the closet. I wanted to make a party for you.
You wanted... No, Snow.
Here it is, Daddy. Look at it.
I feel terrible. Well, why didn't you tell me? I've got a better idea. I'll turn it over.
Why?
You can spank me. I deserve it.
I got the best idea, Daddy.
What is it?
Let's both spank Robespierre.
Come on, now. Let's have a party.
Happy Father's Day, Daddy.
My baby.
Gentlemen, we come to the end of another broadcast. We hope that you have enjoyed your journey to the not so long ago. We return you now to 2015. We'll see you again for our holiday show on Sunday, December 20th, so mark your calendar. And as always, we thank you for your time, this time, until next time. This is WREP